Well, come on, church. From wherever you are today, let's put our hands together and praise him. Here we go. Take is from you. Hope is running through my veins, filling up my heart with joy unending. Love is resurrecting me. Your love is light to me. It's written on my heart like a melody, reminding me in calm and in chaos I cannot outrun. Your love is light to me. It's light to me.
Hope, he is our life, he is peace, he is goodness. I can't think of a more significant time than right now. We need that reminder. No matter where you are, what you are facing, or what you are feeling, he will never let you go. Our God is always faithful.
Oh, my soul, be still. When my heart is fragile, hold fast to the truth, there is hope still in this storm. Help my eyes to see, though my faith is shaken, teach me to believe every word you say is true. You are making all things new. You remind me that you won't let go of me. No, you won't let go of me. Through every high and low, Jesus, you're constant through it all. Firm foundation, so I'm holding on.
You make us your grandeur.
bound my shackles of this earth. From the dust I was created, and to the dust I will return.
Come on.
For a glorious resurrection, I'm restored and raised to life, recreated in your presence. You made dust your grand design. You make dust your grand design. Oh, praise the Lord, the Lord Most High, Word of God, the bread of life, maker of this heart of mine. You make dust your grand, oh, your blessing. Praise the Lord, the Lord Most High, Word of God, the bread of life, maker of this heart.
Good morning, San Jose Open Bible. My name is Pastor Caleb. I am the youth pastor at San Jose Open Bible, and it is fantastic to be able to speak to you this morning, this beautiful Sunday morning. Right now it is Friday as I'm recording this, and there is about a 60 to 70% chance that it's going to be raining Sunday morning, and so hopefully it's not, but in the case of rain, I will be joining you guys watching this online. And I'm so glad that you joined us online for this service. Before I get into our message today, I just want to quickly have you guys check in with us so that we would be able to know who is joining us online. The quickest way to do that for our regular attenders would just be to text CONNECT to 408-547-4911. And if you are a guest with us, welcome. We're so glad to have you online. If you could text GUEST to 408-547-4911. We would love for you to do that, and it would be an awesome way for us to connect with you and get in touch with you and figure out a way that we can connect with you down the road. And so, again, everyone who's joining us online on Facebook or YouTube or wherever you may be watching, thank you so much for plugging in with us this morning, and I'm really excited to get into it. This week, we're going to be talking about worship, and we are going to be finishing up the third week this week in our series. Next week will be the last week. And this series is called God's Ways, Where Do We Go From Here? And we are looking at, over the last 2 weeks and for the next 2 weeks, what it looks like for the early church following Jesus' departure back to heaven to manage and figure out how to start and grow the early church now that Jesus is gone. Christianity is brand new at this time, and the Holy Spirit has now come upon them, and they're just trying to figure this thing out. So they're using the Holy Spirit and guidance from God to figure out how to grow in their faith, how to grow the church, and how to take care of the needs of God's people. And so as we looked at the first week, we looked at community. Last week, we looked at baptism and the importance of that in the Christian faith. And this week, I will be speaking on worship. And so we're going to be speaking on how worship is a very important part of our spiritual life, as well as our church life on Sunday mornings, but not just on Sunday mornings, but throughout the week. And so we're going to look at how the early church modeled that for us and see how we can, as Christians, better exemplify followers of Christ in the way in which we live our lives, take care of others, and can glorify God through our worship, not just on Sunday mornings. And so, when we look at the early church, they have some really cool examples of how they used their practice and their circumstances to help get to know God and help connect with their community in a really amazing way. And as the early church was getting started, they had these cataclysmic events that happened in the early church of growth. It was fantastic. They had people coming from all over. A lot of this was happening in Rome, Palestine, the Middle East, as well as different areas around Europe. But you also had people all over Asia, Africa, and Western Europe as well, kind of coming in to these areas because of the person of Jesus and becoming saved. But what was happening is you were having people coming into these communities, and some of them were just staying. Some of them were going home to share the gospel with family and friends, but some of them just became now a part of these communities. And what they had to do was they had to be taken care of. They had to be fed. They had to have a house. They had to have a place to live. And so God's people got creative. They did what they could do. They sold their land to take care of other people. They just started making it work. And that was God's whole thing, was, hey, you got to make it work. And this is how we're going to survive as the body of Christ. And so as the early Christians really showed us this amazing example of community and sacrifice for other Christians, we got to see how the early church was formed. And so a lot of these early churches weren't functioning in giant buildings. They weren't functioning in really organized, amazing structures. They really didn't have any of that. They just had the stories of Jesus. They had the Old Testament, and they had to kind of figure it out along the way. And God used the Holy Spirit to guide them, to offer correction, to offer rebuke. And so we read the story of the New Testament, and we get these amazing examples of how God, through the Holy Spirit, and how God himself just transformed our world through the early church as the story and the life of Jesus exploded throughout the world. But it started in the Middle East, it started in Europe, and it started in Asia at that time as the early church was just getting its roots and getting ground. And so, as you looked at the early church, they had some really cool structure in how they did things. And it talked about the early growing pains in Acts chapter 6, when it talks about how one area of churches accused another church of neglecting their widows. And so as the early church's responsibility was to take care of the widow and orphan and to take care of their Christian community around them, and they were growing, and all of their people that were speaking and teaching and taking care of people were so busy that they were not organized to make sure that they were taking care of the needs of the surrounding community. So it talks about how they had to reassign leaders, and they had to reassign elders to make sure that the needs of the community were taken care of. And so as we look at the growing pains of the early church, they had to figure out what was important not only to spreading the gospel, but as well as important to making sure that the church was taken care of and that the church was meeting the needs of its own people as well. And that is a function of worship, just like the other areas of worship that we're going to talk about a little bit. Scholars talk about someone named Justin Martyr in 175 AD. And Justin Martyr was someone who was a martyr for our faith. But he has some really cool writings talking about how the early church functioned in Europe at that time. And so it's really cool to look back and read about how they worshiped, how they prayed, how they read, how they discussed, how they ate, how they honored and sacrificed to God. And it's really amazing to read about him because he talks about a lot of the ways in which they prayed and worshiped in the early church. And they had a very important focus, not only on reading scripture, but also on offering prayers of thanksgiving to God. And in their time of prayer, which what I would say would kind of model what we do in our time of worship, they would stand and they would make a direct effort and a very concerted effort to change their posture of worship as they prayed and give thanks to God for their circumstances and for their blessings. And they made a point to do that corporately together because I think they understood the importance of the reverence and honor to God. And so as we look at the way in which they prayed together and they would do something that maybe would model potentially the way that we would also do psalms or hymns and different things like that as a congregation or sing together, we get to take that lesson and look at it as a really important way to understand that worship is often talked about in the Old Testament and in the New Testament in very specific ways as either kneeling before God, bowing down in reverence, or laying prostrate on the ground. And so oftentimes when the Bible is talking about worship, it's not talking about singing a song corporately. Now it does talk about David and his worship to God with his harp. And so there is plenty of examples of musical worship and singing a song to the Lord. And we have poems and psalms and the arts and all these things that are creatively showing our love for God and expressing our thoughts and our anguish and our pain and our thankfulness and our love. And so the Bible has many, many different ways that in which we can show our love to God. But it's very interesting when it talks about worship, a lot of the examples of worship are a physical response of sacrifice and thankfulness and submission to who God is and to what He is asking us to do for Him. And He's asking us oftentimes to sacrifice and step away from our comfort zone in order to show Him the love that He deserves. And so as we look at that, oftentimes worship can be a very stressful or anxious time for some of us if maybe we're not super comfortable singing, or maybe we don't know a song, or maybe we don't really know why we worship. And so I just want this morning, as we look at the ways in which the early church worships, how can we take the ways in which they worship and how can we apply that to our lives? That's going to be the main takeaway from our time this morning. In John 4:24, with the woman at the well, Jesus is talking to this woman and He finishes up His conversation with her and talks about how at one point everyone will worship God in spirit and in truth. And as we look at the idea of worshiping in spirit and in truth, we look at the concept of worshiping in spirit, which has to do with worshiping with a sincere heart. And so I want to challenge everyone to focus on these two things in our worship. When we're worshiping and when we're singing, whether that's in prayer, whether that's in sacrifice, whether that's singing on Sunday morning, to have a sincere heart. So it doesn't mean doing things for the sake of doing them so that other people think you look good, but it's a sincere heart. How can I worship with a sincere heart? How can I honor God with my sincere heart and in truth? It must be grounded in the truth of who God is. We have to be intentionally seeking the truth of who God is, because we can't just make it up. We can't just figure it out as we go, but we have to be intentional to honor God by worshiping who He truly is and not just making up who we think He is. And we find that in the Word of God. Our worship also can't be limited to Sunday mornings. As we look at the early church, it talks about their Sunday service, but it also talks about a Wednesday and a Friday and a Saturday, and it talks about midweek meals, and it talks about all these different things that the early church does in order to stay connected as a community. And so as a church, that doesn't mean we need to have four services a week, but what it means is that our worship is not limited to Sunday mornings. And in Romans 12:1, it says this. It says, in light of God's mercy, because of who He is, He asks us to give our bodies as a spiritual act of worship because of who He is, because of His good and pleasing and perfect will. And so when we look at His call in Romans 12:1 to daily lay down our lives to be glorifying to Him, that makes us realize that our worship is not just limited to Sunday mornings, but our worship is a way of life as we follow Jesus. Our worship is a sacrifice, just like being on our knees in a prayer of thanksgiving, just like standing with our arms raised in sacrifice to who God is and to his call in our lives. And when we worship in spirit and in truth, it's disarming because we no longer can put up the walls that limit what control God has over our heart and our lives. It allows us to be free and fully invested in who he is and in our relationship and our love for him. And so as Christians in 2021, how can we look at the lives and the worship of people from thousands of years ago and use that as a way to learn and grow in our own faith? We have to model them, but also understand that things are a little bit different. It just looks a little bit different. It's not the same. So we don't have to copy every single thing we do, but there are a few different ways in which we can make sure that we are still doing what they're doing. And I think James chapter 2, verse 15 through 16 talks about and says this: if a brother or a sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says, go in peace, be warmed and filled, without giving them the things you need, the things needed for the body, what good is that? And I'll say that one more time. If a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says, go in peace, be warmed and filled, what good is that? Because as Christians, this is talking about, and this section of James is talking about faith that is without works is dead. And so as we look at our faith and we look at worshiping in spirit and in truth, if we are dishonest in our love for our neighbor, if we're dishonest in our love for our widows, like it talks about in Acts 6:1, if we're dishonest in our love for our Christian community, and we're saying things without being genuine, then it's like faith without works, and our faith at that point is dead. If we're saying things like, oh, I love you, oh, I'll take care of you, yeah, I'll pray for you, and we aren't doing those things, we aren't following through, and we don't intend to follow through with those things, it's like faith without works. If we're not making sure that we are taking care of our community, taking care of others, reaching out, we're in the middle, hopefully towards the end of a pandemic, and we have a lot of people in our community, maybe in our neighborhood, who are in need. And so as Christians, this is an amazing example to show our community what we're really about. This is an example for us to step up in our worship, in our honor of God, to do the things that he asked us to do. So maybe that means sacrificing a little bit of time of your own time to help someone else. Maybe that means sacrificing some of your downtime to spend some time in prayer and worship of God. Maybe that means spending some of your time instead of doing one thing, choosing to read the Bible, choosing to worship as a family, choosing to listen to worship music, choosing to be at church on a Sunday more regularly, whatever that looks like for you, whatever personal conviction you may have in on a way that we can grow in our worship, modeled after how the early church worshiped God. As we look at our worship and we understand that it's not limited to Sunday mornings, it's not a ritual, it's not something that we only get to do on Sundays, we understand that we have a, not just a desire, but we have a call and we have a need to be connected to not only our community on Sunday mornings, but as well as our local community of Christian believers and the community around us. And that is how we can worship, not just on Sunday mornings, but throughout the week, every single day. That's how we can daily die to our own desires and live for Christ. It's very, very basic, but I want to challenge you guys to think about the way in which you worship and see if analyzing and reading and hearing about the way in which the early church worshiped, does that change how we worship God? Does that change how we live in our community? And does that change how we interact with those around us? As I wrap up this morning, I want you to think about a few things as before we go. Are we modeling a physical response to worship, in worship, that the Bible talks about when it talks about kneeling before God and bowing down in reverence? Are we physically standing up? Are we changing our posture? Are we changing the posture of our heart as we are entering into worship? Whether that's singing, whether that's any other aspect of worship that I've talked about today. I think the intentionality of those things is so important. So I just want to challenge you guys with those things. Are you physically, intentionally moving, sacrificing in order to show God that we are honoring Him, glorifying Him, surrendering to Him, worshiping Him, whether it's joyfully, whether it's sorrowfully? Maybe we're going through a really hard time, and so we're down on our knees praying. Maybe we're so thankful for something that He has done in our lives, and so we're jumping for joy like David, running and dancing through the streets. And so we get to model worship in every situation. Are we giving thanksgiving in prayer for what He's given us? Are we lamenting like the Psalms? And lastly, are we sacrificing and worshiping every day and not just limiting it to our worship on a Sunday morning during church time? In closing with this, I just want to wrap up my time this morning to encourage us to take something from what I spoke about today, whether that is how we are modeling our worship, whether that is focusing on what our worship looks like outside of Sunday mornings, whether that looks like taking a physical step to worship, whether it's to stand, whether it's to sit or kneel. As Christians, God calls us to sacrifice, to get out of our comfort zone in many, many different ways. And so I would encourage every one of us to find ways in which we can worship outside of our comfort zone, where we can honor and glorify Him for His sacrifice and grow in our faith, as well as helping our community at the same time. As we close today, we're going to finish with a song of worship after I speak and dismiss. But before we do, I just want to ask if anyone has any prayer requests. As a church, we want to continue to pray for our community, for our church family, as we're going through a lot of hard times throughout the pandemic and other things that are happening in this world. And so I just pray for that. But if you would text 408-547-4911, we would love to pray with you for your prayer requests and for your needs. Dear God, thank you so much for all that you have done for us. Thank you for who you are. Thank you for how you have given us the blueprint on how we can worship and how we can do church and do community as a body of Christ. And so thank you for all that you've done for us. And I just pray that we would continue to grow in our faith, continue to grow in our expressions of worship, and continue to grow in our trust in you as we go through hard times in this world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you again for joining us this morning, and I hope you have a great week. Times people
I forever am in you. Maybe since my life has changed, long before those rainy days, it's never really ever crossed my mind. Turn my back shelter from the storm, but instead I draw closer through these times. So I bring me joy, bring me peace, bring the chance to be free, bring me anything that brings you glory. And I know there'll be days when this life brings me pain, but if that's what it takes to praise you, Jesus, bring the rain. Oh. I am yours regardless of clouds that may loom above, because you are much greater than suffering your destiny. So tell me, what's a little rain? So I pray, bring me joy, bring me peace, bring the chance to be free, bring me anything that brings you glory. And I know there'll be days when this life brings me, but if that's what it takes to praise you, Jesus, bring the rain. Oh, Jesus, bring the rain. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The Lord God Almighty. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Is the Lord God Almighty. Is the Lord God.